explain Med's question, and I'll let maybe that'll help answer it. Thank you.
Man, okay. I that didn't erase everything before.
Good. Okay. Okay, we get CJ back, we'll be all set. I had a couple other things. Be long, because we want to get to Hebrews before your graduation starts. Med's question went something like this, if I can remember right. When did Christianity sort of stop being a Jewish thing and become a totally Gentile thing? Okay. I don't think anybody can say exactly it happened on April 1st of 52 AD, that kind of a thing.
Well, that was April Fool's Day.
I just made that up. That's why I did it, because it fools me. You know, fool. But anyway, you got to remember, the movement starts, the apostles are Jews. Okay? The first Christians are Jews. The first converts, if you will, are essentially Jews. Because remember, Peter does that Pentecost Day sermon for all these Jews that have come in, and those Gentiles have been converted to Judaism on Pentecost, right? And they hear him, and everyone in their own language heard his speech, and he brought in like 3,000 that day, whatever it's a, okay? So they start out thinking of themselves as Jews who have found the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth. And it kind of grows like that. Paul, remember, goes to the synagogue first. When he's turned out of the synagogue, he starts going to the Gentiles. And they start coming in. In the 40s, there was an emperor by the name of Claudius. Remember from I, Claudius, and Derek Jacobi? I saw him twice on the London stage when I lived there. Three times. And there was a big brouhaha between the Jews who did not accept Jesus and the Jews who did accept Jesus in Rome. And he threw the Jews out. And by that he meant the Jewish Christians too, out of Rome. And then of course when his successor came in, Nero, you know, the emperors always forgave things when they took over, right, and released prisoners and did all kinds of stuff. Then these people were out to come back, and by that time, most of the church in Rome was Gentile Christians and stuff like that. As long as Christianity was thought to be part of Judaism, it was protected by all those laws that I talked about. Like, for example, there was a law that you all know from the Gospels that a Roman could make somebody carry their armor for a mile. Remember? Jesus says, no, carry it 2 miles. Somebody asks you. Well, they couldn't do that on the Sabbath. They couldn't make the Jews go to law court on the Sabbath. So this was a religion that was protected, okay, in a certain way. Until the Jews, of course, were always feisty and fighting about something. They would have a rebellion and that kind of a thing. But eventually, when you get into the 60s, Nero, remember, persecutes the Christians, right? And they start to become more and more identified as their own group. And this develops a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. And by the time you probably get to 90 or so, in the Jewish synagogue service, there's a blessing, which really is a curse, against these people that they think they were referring to followers of Jesus. Okay, that kind of a thing. So it takes a while for it. When they start persecuting it separately, it becomes more and more of its own separate religion. Okay, and becomes more and more Gentile. Remember, it's not in this course, but in one of these years when you read Romans, Paul has to try to come to some explanation of why there aren't this great conversion of Jews. Why is he so successful with the Gentiles and not with the Jews. If they're the elect, they're the chosen people. And he says, I'd be willing to give up my salvation if it brought all them in to the fold, kind of a thing. So there's this, it grows. It separates and separates and separates and separates and separates and separates. And it starts to go its own way. The destruction of the temple changes Judaism from sacrifice, worship in the temple. Eventually, the synagogue will become the worship service. It's replacing, in a sense, the temple. Christ followers will pull out no circumcision, no dietary laws, no we eat pork all the time. You know, there's no question about that. Okay, and we become more and more and more and more Gentile. And certainly, during those first few centuries A.D., They just go their own separate ways. Now the question then becomes, there were people in the early church who said, we don't even need the Old Testament. Right? Marcion and those people. And the Catholic Church always said, no, we do. Because as Jesus said, salvation is from the Jews. It's part of salvation history. The covenant. Okay. Up to Jesus. So that's the best explanation I can give. I don't think anybody can say exactly what happened with this, but it's growing. With Paul and other preachers like Paul going more and more to the Gentiles, it's becoming more and more. When less and less Jews get involved, when they put that prayer into the synagogue service, cursing these people we think they mean Christians, we're becoming more and more of a Gentile religion. Is that? I think that's the best explanation I could give to Med. Med, is that okay with you? No. You know, but that's about the best I can do with that. Any other quick question while Don is handing out our review? And CJ. I really don't know. I doubt it. I think that they probably have the same sensibilities we do. You know, we don't want to offend them. I don't know it off by heart, but there was a series of what they called blessings in the service, and one of these so-called blessings was really a curse against some people, and they gave a name to it, but people think they meant Jews who had accepted Jesus as the Messiah.
Don't forget, Father, we had one.
Well, we had it in Good Friday service.
Thank you.
Okay. What we do last week? Well, we had a review of week one, right? Handout.
Right.
And then we did the 2 Corinthian readings. Remember, 2 Corinthians is different than 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians is driven by specific problems in Corinth. Paul got a letter. Paul had closed people come. Okay. 2 Corinthians. Now Paul is defending himself. Okay. And his integrity is an apostle and things like that. We saw Christological themes there. Paul's developing this. Christ is the image of God. Okay. Christ reconciles the world to himself. Okay. There's the power of Christ in Paul's life. Paul is now carries within his body, you know, the marks of Christ's suffering, you know, that kind of a thing. We're righteous, we're put in the right relationship with God because of what Jesus did. Ministerial things, there's the ministry of a new covenant that reveals the glory of God that shines on the face of Christ. Remember we talked about that. There's the call to reconciliation, we're reconciled to God through Christ. And the ministers represent God to the people. Okay. And then we went through the Ephesians readings. Remember there are some people who contest Paul's writing of this. You don't have to believe it. If Paul didn't write it, it's one of his captivity letters. Why he's in captive someplace, he's in prison someplace. He talks about the economy of salvation, God's plan. God always had this plan in mind. And that the moral life is our response to this plan. Christ suffered and died for us. He put us into right relationship with God. Now we need to stay there by leading a good moral life. living the way Christ would want us to live, that kind of a thing. Ephesians gets more into the mystery of the church. It's now just not a house church in somebody's home. There's a thought of it being a universal church, and continuing growing of this theology of the body of Christ, okay? And this idea of divine election. Now, Jews and Greeks are both elected. They're both chosen people, that kind of a thing. And Jews and Gentiles come together through Christ's cross, okay? And then we started that little bit on the video. So anybody want to make any comments about that or say anything or question about that? If not, we've got to get into this book of Hebrews. And we've mentioned a little bit about it before. The format of Hebrews, except for the very ending of it, is not like a letter. And scholars will say it's really more like a series of sermons that have been stitched together. It makes extensive use of the Hebrew scriptures. They're quoting the Hebrew Bible all the time. Okay. The early church, particularly in the East, always ascribed it to Paul. Okay. So it's not surprising that many Christians still think of Hebrews as a Pauline work. Okay. Though the work itself doesn't claim Pauline authorship in any place that you can find. Okay. Second, Hebrews plays a very significant part in our lectionary. You know, we had a couple quotes in the video from 1 Thessalonians. We've been reading that the last couple Sundays. You should have been familiar to you, okay? It appears 7 times during year B, what we're reading, and 4 times during year C, okay, which we'll read next year. And third, and most importantly, Hebrews is among the most profoundly theological writings in the New Testament, okay? So it's thought to be one of the late works. The historical context, the background of Hebrews is very mysterious, you know, and its theology is very profound. The author, the audience, and the occasion for this work are all matters of dispute. Nobody knows for sure, okay? And like I said, literary context, though Hebrews is traditionally called an epistle, a letter, it doesn't really begin like any other letter in the New Testament. It opens with an elegant sentence that announces the theme which its author will develop in the rest of the writing, which is verses 1:1-4. And we don't really read that, so let's just read. In times past, God spoke in partial and various ways to our ancestors through the prophets. In these last days, remember, they always think they're in the last days. We're in the last days, too. That last day's been kind of long, if you think about it, okay? He spoke to us through a son. Whom he made heir of all things, and through whom he created the universe. Okay? Who is the refulgence of his glory, reflects his glory. Okay? The very imprint of his being. Consubstantial, we're going to say in the creed, right? Okay? Consubstantial. And who sustains all things by his mighty word. God's providence. This is the theology of God's providence. Okay? And that's Jesus that does that. Okay? When he accomplished purification from sins, suffering, death, he took a seat at the right hand of the majesty on high. You say that in Creed, right? Right hand of the Father. As far as superior to the angels, as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Okay. Remember throughout some of the Pauline writings, we get these people that are like angel and like astrology people. All kinds of beings in the sky and all this other kinds of stuff. And so Paul and other writers keep saying, Jesus is far superior to all those, you know, all those things that you think are up there. Okay? So that's how this whole thing begins. Okay? That kind of a thing. Okay? So let's take a look at the first thing that we have to read, which is Hebrews chapter 2, verses 9-11. But we do not see Jesus crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death. He who for a little while was made lower than the angels, that by the grace of God he may taste death for everyone. Christ died once for all. Okay? For it was fitting that he, for whom and through whom, through him, with him, in him, right? In the unity of the Holy Spirit, okay? Okay? Should make the leader to their salvation, Jesus is the leader to our salvation, perfect through suffering. Okay? And this becomes a little bit of the foundation for the Catholic view theology of redemptive suffering. Okay? We suffer, and it's redeeming. Somebody came to me today. She was supposed to come tonight, but she's too sick, I guess, and didn't come. And she said, I'm offering it up for the souls in purgatory. I'm in real pain. And they gave me all these purgatory and all these other kinds of stuff, you know, and I'm still hurt, but I can handle it because I'm offering it up for others. My suffering is joined to the sufferings of Christ. And so we hear our God subjected the coming world to, and not to the ant, but okay. I think I pretty well did all that. Okay. Okay. What's the next one on our list? Chapter 4, verses 12 to 13. Okay. Indeed, the word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword. We're familiar with that verse, aren't we?
Yes.
Penetrating even between soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and able to discern reflections and thought of the heart. Okay? No creature is concealed from him, but everything is naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom he must render an account. Okay? And who do we have to render an account to? Jesus, huh? Jesus, okay. Is where Jesus, the Son of God, was faithful to God, okay? People rebel, okay? He wants to come to us, you know, in the Psalms. Remember Psalm 95? We hear about harden not your hearts, okay? The Word of God, Jesus renders judgment, just as Psalm 95 does in exposing the disobedience of the wilderness generation, okay? And the writer of Hebrews says, well, you know, when you hear God's word, okay, it can become a source of salvation if you act on it, if it becomes effective in your life. If you hear the word and you don't act on it, then it becomes your judgment, doesn't it? We're going to have this Sunday at Mass the ultimate parable about the last judgment. In Matthew, aren't we? The parable of the sheep and the goats. You know? He's going to say, you know, what did you do to the least of my brethren? You did to me. Okay. Jesus and everybody else. And so we need to listen to God's word. We need to hear it, not ignore it, and act on it, make it effective. And it'll be effective just like a two-edged sword can be effective, you know, I guess. You know, you can chop this way, and you know, and cut between things and everything else like that. And so we got to listen to God's word, and then put it into our hearts, and not have our hearts be hardened, but be willing to listen to that word and to live that. And then the next one takes up the next three verses. Therefore, it's verses 14 to 16. Since we have a great high priest, and Hebrews is the only book in the New Testament that refers to Christ as a priest. Okay. Now think about this. If you're used to the Jewish priesthood, this you know why the other books don't call Jesus a priest. Right? Because your name had to be Cohen or something to be a priest. You were born a priest because you were born into a family. You didn't discern a vocation. When John the Baptist was born, since Zechariah was a priest, by definition, John the Baptist was a priest. It's the Levitical priesthood. And much of what the Hebrew book of Hebrews is going to say is, just like Torah,
couldn't put you in the right relationship to God, that faith in Jesus, in the sense of his suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension, puts you in the right relationship to God. Christ suffered, died once for all. The Levitical priesthood, no matter how many sacrifices they did at the temple every day, couldn't suffice for Jesus' sacrifice on the cross once for all. So Jesus is a priest in that sense, the true high priest, okay, who suffered once and for all and put us into this right relationship to God. That all those sacrifices from the very beginning, Abraham and whatever, Noah, whatever, were never able to do those animal sacrifices. Okay? So he's going to compare and contrast, just that Paul compare and contrast Torah and Jesus, Levitical priesthood, and Christ suffering and death as the high priest. Okay? And we share in that high priesthood of Christ. You share in it in terms of the common priesthood of believers, the lay people, and I share in it by the ministerial priesthood through holy orders. And I always like to make the statement that people will ask, who is the celebrant of the 11:30 Mass today? Christ is. Christ is. Okay. We share in that. Okay. You through common priesthood, I representing him. But he is the celebrant of the 11:30 Mass. Go back to the catechism. They're going to tell you the celebrant of all the sacraments is Jesus Christ. Okay. He uses the ministerial priesthood take its place, to stand in physically. I can do things that you can't do. You can offer yourself at the Mass, but you can't turn the bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ. I can, not because I'm any better than you, I'm not, but because of holy orders. Okay? But he's the celebrant. Not me, not Father Clark, not Father Jacek, really. We're just standing in. That's why I always say, Christ is in management, I'm in public relations. Now, Don's going to take offense. Okay, go ahead.
Just, the point that I was trying to make before is that in the documents of the Second Vatican Council, of course, the study that we had with Father Bruce pointed out that we offer that sacrifice with the priest.
But my sacrifice is different than your sacrifice. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that your sacrifice and mine may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. The Latin never said our sacrifice. It's your sacrifice and mine. I do it in a different way because I'm the holy orders person.
But we all
offer. We should all offer ourselves, everything we have to the Father, good and bad. And that's the reason why I wrote that one open letter. It said, prepare before you come to Mass. Think about what's happened this past week, good and bad. Come, and when the gifts come up, spiritually, offer those things at the Mass. Okay? But I sacramentally don't die essentially at that Mass. Okay? It's Christ who's the real celebrant of that Mass. But we enter into his sacrifice, but in a different way. And that's the reason why I have presidential prayers that I say as the presider, and I have prayers that I say in the person of the church. And the reason why I can say the words of institution, something happens. You can say those same words, and no matter how holy you are, it's not the same thing. Do you see that?
I have always wondered if all the priests on the face of the earth died,
Are you wishing that, or?
Would it not still be possible to offer the sacrifice of the men?
That's an interesting question, because you wouldn't have anybody to confect the Eucharist. You could offer a lot of other things. And it's nothing to say that those things are important.
But that will never happen. God said he would be with his church.
Thank you, Catherine. The Holy Spirit is with the church.
It always bothered me that, like, when we were out to sea, I was on a small ship, and the few of us Catholics that were there gathering on the Pandale and said the rosary on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Why could not one of us have been elected? We were talking about the priesthood of our Christianity by virtue of our baptism.
Mm-hmm.
And orders raising one of those people.
If there was a bishop around, he could have ordained you, that would have happened.
And it kind of gets back to the thing with being no priest left on the face of the earth. I don't know if you heard.
Well, there was a time when there weren't any Catholic priests on the face of the earth, and people still lived and died and prayed and did things that got them to heaven.
But never
this way. No, but if you believe that the church is a sacramental church, then there's, and you believe in apostolic succession.
And that we are the church.
Yes, but there are different functions within the church. It's a hierarchical church. You need to watch Father Barron's series on Catholicism.
Okay.
So it's been on EWTN.
I don't watch EWTN.
What is
that?
Well, let's get back to Hebrews chapter 5. You can get them from the Catholic Library, and also there's another one on tonight at 10 o'clock.
And off Saturday.
And off and on Saturday. It's not every hour. No, because unless DirecTV is wrong when I went through the list, because I'm recording them on my DVR. And I've also been, in my other set, I've been using VHS tapes to make copies too, if we have a TV that works. Every high priest is taken from among men and made their representative before God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal patiently with the ignorant and erring, for he himself is beset by weakness. Yeah, we are. And so for this reason, must make sin offerings for himself as well as for the people. No one takes this honor upon himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. In the same way, it was not Christ who glorified himself in becoming high priest, but rather the one who said to him, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you." It's Psalm 2. Just as he says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." It was Melchizedek, that strange figure that shows up in Genesis, that when he meets Abraham, offers a sacrifice of bread and wine, and then Abraham gives him a tithe of everything Abraham owns, a tenth. So what Abraham is doing by doing that, he's saying, I recognize that you are a superior of mine. You're at a higher level than me. Here's my tithe. Okay. And he's a mysterious figure. He seems to have come from nowhere and kind of disappears into nowhere. God. We didn't have sacraments then. Jesus hadn't been here yet.
No, I know. The fact is that the God also, declared Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
No place to what you just said. He's still a mysterious figure.
He's a mysterious figure.
It recognizes him as a priest, but it never said how he ever became.
No, he doesn't know where he came from or where he went to. Oh, yeah.
As he was saying, there's a gentleman was there that has gotten out of the priest. He's a priest. Well, a priest is a priest forever.
In one sense, yes, because even if he's been laicized, in emergency, he can hear confession. But he can't say mass.
Yeah, I know, but that's what I was wondering, because he said that it has to be a priest. priest there. Actually, he's still a priest.
Technically, we say that there are certain sacraments that give an indelible mark on the soul. And that's one of them. Holy orders. And therefore, for that sense, you're a priest forever in that sense. But you can become laicized, and therefore you're not a functioning priest, except for confessions in an emergency. So always hope you get one of those aboard a plane or something that can hear confessions, okay, when the time comes, you know, and do that. Okay, chapter 7, verses 23 to 28. Those priests were many because they were prevented by death from remaining in office. In other words, they had a tenure, you know, and then they were gone. But he, Jesus, because he remains forever, has a priesthood that does not pass away. Therefore, he is always able to save those who approach God through him, since he lives forever to make intercession for them. It is fitting that we should have such a high priest. What kind of high priest? Holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, higher than the heavens. He has no need, as did the high priest, to offer sacrifice day after day, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. He did that once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints men subject to weakness to be high priests. But the word of the oath, which was taken after the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. So Jesus, Tom?
Just comment, he was the priest, but he was also the victim.
That's right, he's a priest, victim, everything. And he still is in the Mass, sacramentally. Every Mass. He does that, okay? Okay, so what can we say about this? So first, the Old Covenant required many priests because death prevented them from continuing office. And as each generation died, it needed to be replenished by another. And second, more importantly, the old priesthood offered daily sacrifice that did not deal effectively with sin. But Christ dealt with sin once and for all by a single sacrifice of himself. Okay. So therefore, Hebrews says there's no further need for the priesthood of the old covenant. Okay. The unique nature of Jesus' priesthood, that eternal priesthood, makes every other priesthood irrelevant unless it participates in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. That's what I said. That's why he really is the celebrant at the Mass. Not the RH, JC, or JK that's in the bullet. You just know who's there for that. Okay? That kind of a thing. Okay? In assembling for the Eucharist each week, the Christian community, united with its high priest, sacramentally participates in the sacrifice which deals with sin once and for all. Okay? And then chapter 9, verses 24 to 28. For Christ did not enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but heaven itself, that he might now appear before God on our behalf. Not that he might offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters each year into the sanctuary with blood that is not his own. If that were so, he would have had to suffer repeatedly from the foundation of the world. But now, once for all, he has appeared at the end of the ages. Here we go, the end of the ages. To take away sin by his sacrifice. Justice is appointed that human beings die once, and after this, the judgment. So also Christ, offered once to take away the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. Okay? So we hope that when we have our final judgment, we're eagerly awaiting him. Okay? So we're not afraid of that kind of thing. What else can I say? Okay, so they're again comparing the Levitical, the old cult priesthood with the new one. Okay, and in contrast to them, Christ freely offered himself as a sacrifice for sins by shedding his own blood. Okay, and you know, when you talk about the priest going in, of course, on the Day of Atonement, when the high priest entered the Holy of Holies, Christ entered the heavenly sanctuary with his own blood to atone for sins once for all. His gruesome death on the cross with the entrance of the high priest according to the order of Melchizedek into the heavenly sanctuary. It was the perfect sacrifice for sins now and forever. And that's why we always make the point that our earthly Mass is connected to the heavenly liturgy that's going on. the communion of saints. So you can figure that the saints are there with us when we come to celebrate Mass. Because we're, on, in an earthly way, have this foretaste of heaven. That's the reason why the Eucharist is always referred to as the foretaste of the heavenly banquet of heaven. Okay, so we're connected with this thing. It's very, it's a very Catholic idea, this communion of saints, that we're all together. Okay, kind of a thing. And then last but not least, chapter 10. Oh, yeah, Cliff.
In verse 28, when he's supposed to come the second time, mm-hmm. To bring salvation to all those the way he can. Mm-hmm. So is that saying, I guess, those who have already died haven't received salvation yet?
Yeah, no, they're talking about this as like the second, the final judgment. Remember, we have, in the Catholic theology, you have the judgment when you first die. But there's still also Jesus is going to come at the end of time. And there's going to be another general judgment for those who are still alive and everything. Those who are in hell are in hell. Those who are in heaven are in heaven. But you're talking about him coming to do this judgment for everybody. And that hopefully that through living this moral life and through participating in Christ's sacrifice and everything else, then salvation will come to us who are alive at the time when he comes too. Just like it is for the people who have already died or are in heaven.
Okay. But we studied that there won't be any more purgatory once he comes a second time. Between heaven and hell, and that's all.
Probably. I mean, probably everybody will be purgated. Purged.
And it says that the people that are living then will just have to go to heaven or hell.
I've never heard it explained like that, but I'm not saying that's wrong. I don't know. Did Father Bruce say that?
I'm sure he said it. Somewhere I've heard it.
I don't know. I've never heard it explained quite like that. I'd have to go back and read the catechism a little bit. But I mean, people are going to be judged. And people have to be in the right disposition to see God face to face. That's why we think there is a purgatory. I'll go back and reread that section of catechism, and we'll put it in a Did You Know column in the paper. Or I'll do it at the Did You Know on not this Monday, because I already got 7 questions for this Monday. But I'll put it in one of the Did You Know classes. Because does purgatory go away when the parousia happens? I'll see if I can find something definitive that says that.
Father, uh-huh. For someone who might need reinforcement, when discussing things with others of our sisters and brothers about the one sacrifice Jesus made for all, and then us sharing in that sacrifice at each Mass, how do we reconcile that? That's one of the things that I know. That one sacrifice that is used against us, and I know that I had to be squarely with this in my mind at some point in time, but then when I'm confronted with it.
Well, what is the Mass? Well, in one sense, it's the bloody sacrifice of Calvary. In another sense, it's the meal. Do this in remembrance of me? Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think he would have said, do this in remembrance of me, if he just meant it for that night. I mean, why would he say that? He wants this thing to be perpetuated forever until he comes back. And that's one of the things that, when you think about it, that liturgy does, and why I think it first continued, was liturgy keeps the memory of Christ alive in our lives. And therefore, we have this sacrifice and banquet both, that we do in remembrance of him, and therefore keep his memory alive. He told us to perpetuate this. That's the answer I would give. Does that make any sense to you?
Yeah, it just when I heard the explanation, or when we were discussing it before, it sounded mm-hmm. as if we're saying that he is sacrificed each and every Mass, and
no,
I want to make sure that that's absolutely not.
He suffered once and for all.
Right.
This is a sacramental thing, signs and symbols. Okay, and it's the efficacious result of that sacrifice, the grace from that, that takes place at that Mass. So he's not crucified every day in the four corners of the world around the clock. But the merits and the grace and sacramentally
received
is
daily.
Received now every day. I mean, when the first church first started, I'm sure they just did it on the Sabbath. And then they realized, well, why do we have to just wait for the Sabbath to do this? We can do it on the Sabbath. We can do it other days too. And so it became a daily. And then they said, wait, so give us this day our daily bread. So all these things, I think, went into this development of the idea of this doing it on a daily basis. Is that right? Okay, Don.
You know, Father, isn't there the aspect, though, that we are reliving that moment of the Last Supper, that we are all part and parcel of that?
It's not history being reenacted. It's mystery. There's a difference between history and mystery. You're not mimicking what happened. It's not like a passion play. It's the mystery of the merits and salvation and grace that came from that event. In a certain sense, it's sacramentally, it's happening again, but it's not physically happening. He's not dying again.
No.
Okay?
I'm saying like what you were saying before, that it's Christ who is the soul.
You gotta watch what you're doing, because, like, for example, people think that on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday, what we're doing is reenacting Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday. That's history.
As a mystery.
The merits of that Last Supper. It's not that like we're pretending like. I mean, people may talk that way, but that's not what's happening. The best thing to do, I suggest that you do, is look at the Ordo. When you see the 2012 Ordo, or even if it's still in the one from 2011, about the Triduum and what's actually happening on the Triduum. It's not history happening on the Triduum. It's mystery that's happening on the Triduum. And now, what does this mean in our lives, that Last Supper?
You said Ordo. What is that?
Ordo is a book that comes out. Certain areas will print it and say, January 1st, Solemnity of Mary the Mother of God. Officer readings, blah, 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 blah. Mass, Gloria, Creed, and it tells you what Mass you can say that day. It gives you like about two sentences about what the readings are for that Mass. It tells you what you're going to read in the Liturgy of the Hours for that day and everything else. It gives you the order of things for each day of the year. It's in the sacristy. Okay? There's one in the work sacristy here where you all get the cups and stuff together. Okay? It's what I consult when I go. I'm going to have Mass Saturday morning. Okay? Well, I'm going to have Mass tomorrow. I got the 8:30 Mass with the kids. The Mass is going to tell me that it's green, white, red. In other words, it's a green day, which means there's no required memorial, but there are two optional memorials for tomorrow. And it's going to tell me what readings I would use depending on whether or not I wear green, white, or red, or whatever. Okay? I don't know if it's really red or not. It might be green, white, and white, because it's about green, white, and white, because it's about Peter and Paul, but it's about their churches. It's an optional memorial about dedication of the basilicas of Peter and Paul. Okay, so it's probably white rather than red, like their martyrdom would be, but it'll tell me exactly what to read. And whenever you get into a season, it will have a description about that season. It'll say Lent, and this gets very confusing, because it'll say pre-Lent, Ash Wednesday through that Saturday of that week, and then Lent, the first Sunday of Lent, and then Lent ends Thursday night, and the triduum starts, and it gets very confusing, and everybody's mind goes boggled, you know, what are they really talking about? But it'll explain all that, and it'll explain what the triduum is. And most of the time in that book, they'll try to make a major imprint on your mind that when you come into to Mass for Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday, it's not like a reenactment of Greatest Story Ever Told, okay? You're not reliving, in that sense, reliving history to that. It's a mystery going on, and you're taken into the mystery. Now, what's the effects of that mystery? That means by being efficacious. The sacraments are efficacious. They provide grace to those who are properly disposed to receive it. That Holy Thursday night, when Jesus instituted the Eucharist and washed his disciples' feet, what does that mean now? Are we a different person because of that? When we receive the Eucharist? When we do this thing, and the pastor, and this year it's going to be Yosik, unless his back keeps him from doing it, but I got a bad back too, so Yosik's doing it. You know how much I do on Holy Thursday night, because I do. I've got arthritis in the back, and so when I do that foot, I'm hurting when I do that. And Yosik, I told Yosik he could do that this year. But anyway, it's not meant to be like a play of that. It's supposed to be a symbolic gesture. That's how I'm supposed to treat my flock. I'm supposed to be here to minister to you with that same sort of humility that Christ had. And the Eucharist I receive, the grace, does that make me more like Christ in my dealings with other people? Yeah, we remember the Last Supper, and remember in that Jewish sense that in a certain way it's an event that happens, but it happens sacramentally, and it's the grace. It's not history, it's mystery. And that's why you ought to read that section. It's a fine line of theology. It's not mimicking anything. It's not mimosis or whatever it is in Greek. It's not mine. Does that make sense to you? You're looking at me strange. Read the order.
Sure.
Read the
what
order.
What do you mean by it's mystery and not history? I never thought that it was that we went back in history, but that we were now present with Christ in the upper room.
Not in that sense of the word. We're present with Christ at 6529 Stage Road. Now, you can think when you meditate, just like when you read Scripture, Lectio Divina, you can pretend like you're there, and you can study the Bible that way, and you can do all those other kinds of things. But that's not what, as I understand it, what we're doing. We're doing mystery here. You know, the efficacious quality of that. It's not like we're back in the upper room. Now, you have people that will say that, but that, we say a lot of things. Just like we say, somebody was Lutheran and he converted. But Lutheran doesn't convert to Catholicism. Lutheran comes into full communion with Catholicism. You know, a Gentile, a pagan comes in and converts to Catholicism. He's already a Christian. So sometimes we're very loose in our language. But I would urge you, Don, get a hold of the Ordo and read that section of the difference between history and mystery. This is supposed to be an effect on us. Okay. Now you might want to pretend like you're in the upper room, but that is some way that makes you feel better. But we're here in Bartlett with Christ. And we need to take Christ out into our homes. We're missioned out. That's what the Mass is about. Wow. Okay. Hebrews 10, 11 to 14, and then 18. Every priest stands daily at his ministry, offering frequently those sacrifices that can never take away sins. But this one offered one sacrifice for sins and took a seat forever at the right hand of God. Now he waits until his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has made perfect forever those who are being consecrated. Okay? Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer offering for sin. In other words, he doesn't have to die again. to take the sins away. He died once and for all of our sins. Okay.
Why did they offer sacrifices, sin offerings, when they didn't take away sin?
Well, they thought that they did.
Yeah, I guess David thought it did too.
They did. What really saves us? Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection. That's the true sacrifice. We can look at that now and go back because we're in the new covenant. Okay? And we see the old covenant in types. Okay? Typology. You know? They were foreshadowings of the real sacrifice to come. Were they efficacious for some people? Yeah. If they lived a good life, they sinned, they were sorry for their sins, Christ's sacrifice would let them in. Remember the harrowing of hell? You know, he descended into hell, the third day arose again from the dead. Okay? So But the real sacrifice that matters, and they're trying to say this is Jesus' sacrifice that really mattered, and all those other sacrifices were just foreshadowings of the real sacrifice. And what we have sacramentally is that real sacrifice now. We call it the Mass. And we all participate in that in our own way, by our own function. Okay. I dare say, anything else? Well, I hope you got something out of all this, and I hope you enjoyed it. Mary Frances Anthony.